This podcast is brought to you by EFL 6452 Senior Project. Hello again, this is Sudara Chetana and welcome to another episode of Why So Wong, a podcast series exploring Wong Kar Wai solitude aesthetics. In the last episode, our first one, I was introducing you to Wong Kar Wai and also the concept of loneliness and also his, you know, filmography, his stylistic filming techniques. So, in this episode, I will be continuing talking about Wong Kar Wai in terms of his life after he grew up, when he started going to, you know, design school, and then he worked with the first new wave directors of Hong Kong. And after I discuss about his life as a director, his early life of a screenwriter and director, I will talk about the protagonist of his films that appeared. No, that is phantom. That means it's not there, but it's there in every film, and it is Hong Kong. As I have told you that Wong Kar Wai is exploring loneliness in different contexts, but the common thing every film have together is the dislocated Hong Kong. It is unbelievable that a melodrama stories can talk about politics in a very poetic ways. So I can say that Hong Kong is like the phantom protagonist here, and we will see why together in this episode. So normally it is known that Wong Kar Wai grew up in Hong Kong, and when he like 15 or 20s, he went to a polytechnic school studying graphic design, and then he was trained at the local television network, and that's where he learned the process of media production. And then later he started working with the first new wave director, and the one who has the huge influence on him is Patrick Tam. So Patrick Tam's contribution to the first new wave movement in Hong Kong came by his interest in influence of the West and Japan on Hong Kong. So he explored a society that rapidly consuming Western and Japanese popular culture that led him to reveal no man's land of Hong Kong cultural, spiritual, and geographical dislocation. So it sounds familiar, right? It reminds me of Chungking Express that reflects the themes of dislocation and alienation. This is Tam's interest too, and after working with Tam for a while, Wong Kar Wai becomes the scriptwriter for Tam's too in like roughly 1980s, The Final Victory. And then in 1991, Wong is producing Days of Being Wild and is also supervised by Tam too. So both directors combined their preoccupation with themes of isolation and dislocation with a striking visual aesthetic. In the first new wave, I can say the common themes among the filmmakers was linked to the social and political issues facing Hong Kong. So the themes connect the identity of Hong Kong relation to China, that it is broadened and modernized. I can say Wong is trying to subtly talk about the identity of Hong Kong, which goes hand in hand with modernity and loneliness. Speaking of the history of loneliness, before the 18th century or 19th century, the words like individuals or loneliness is rarely used until the world is modernized by the industrial revolutions. So trying to imagine the industry that people works in a factory and the routine becomes mundane. You have to wake up at 7, try to get to work before 9, and then work until 4 or 5, and then go home, sleep. And in the next day, you do the same and repeat it throughout the month, the year, and your life. Additionally, people that living in a community in a village, suburban area, had moved to the city, and that's the beginning of the urban life. And what happens in a city? Urbanization occurs. There are a lot of tall buildings. People live in the box-shaped rooms that stacked in a tall rectangle buildings, and these buildings spread throughout the town. In the Mood for Love, it's the same. Wong Kar Wai also trying to portray modernity in the mid-20th century. So you can see from the rice cooker imported from Japan, people live in a suffocating space in the same apartment. These kind of traits, like the imports and exports, also talks about free trade and capitalism. And from there, when the Industrial Revolution is too overwhelming, the urban lives is so crowded and overwhelming as well, the individualism has emerged, and more people tended to pay for privacy, like they pay for a private car or a room for one or two. So in Hong Kong, this is the heritage of the British colonialism. And then Wong Kar Wai is trying to look back to the relationship between China and Hong Kong again. The settings in 1960s and the characters are moved from somewhere, and it's presumably from the mainland China. They are the Shanghainese, moved to the Shanghainese community that lives in one big house or big apartment. So the portrayal of the immigrants here is signaling the dislocation. So the characters connotes Hong Kong in terms of its dual identity. So Hong Kong has duly created its own culturally specific identity, one that inevitably combines both elements from the West and mainland China. For example, the dress of the women is the Chinese heritage, while the suit and tie of men characters connotes the influence from the West, as well as the music, the Western music and Spanish music. So these notions of identity and ever-present fusion between East and West find context in the themes of love, loneliness, and alienation that pervade his protagonists. So his protagonists are caught in a quasi-dreamscape where time and memory cannot be secure. They cannot protect this particular period of time, as you can see from the Cheongsam dress that changes every scene. It ritualized that change is destined for Hong Kong. And what the characters can do is nothing but to go with the flow, as well as the clocks in every frame that still progress. So the camera studies the stark back and white face of the clock as it attempts to capture the time that is constantly advancing. Speaking of changes or transition, I'm thinking of the last scene, the almost last scene of In the Mood for Love. There's a historical footage of a French whose name is Charles de Gaulle. He visited leader of the Cambodia in 1996 on the eve of the Vietnam War. And it is the same day as the start of China's Cultural Revolution. This scene is a metaphorical staging for Hong Kong as a transit destination for Chinese migrants. It is foreshadowing the future and major changes of Hong Kong.
What a difference a day made. 24 little hours. What the sun and the flowers.
Actually, my list of three films are not sequels of Wong Kar Wai's films as the researchers that study Wong Kar Wai. My list is just like trying to convey Hong Kong in three different periods. But as I have read, there is a trilogy of Hong Kong anxiety portrayed in three films. First is Days of Being Wild, then In the Mood for Love, and 2046. I think Chungking Express is a very clear example of the modern loneliness and alienation, Hong Kong anxiety, and most importantly, Hong Kong as a transitional space. So the notable and the major theme of Chungking Express is travel. From the title, Express connotes travel, and the characters is determined and intended to go somewhere, leaving the country. The ex-girlfriends of both characters are gone, traveled far away. I don't even know how long they have gone, but they are gone. So both of the cops are stuck in between the past and the future. Meanwhile, Faye is stuck in the present moment. It is portrayed through the use of music, California Dreaming. Trying to understand the lyrics, I would conclude that the Faye is meant to gone away. Like, if I didn't tell you, I would leave today. So Faye knows that in the end she has to go, but in the meantime she's stuck in love, she's stuck in the present moment with Cop 63. So I'm wondering if Faye, if we replace her with Hong Kong, I think she is Hong Kong. And when she has left to California as she's been dreaming of, she comes back and she found out like that the cop isn't there anymore. So she is struggling with the lost memory as well as the cop 663 does. Meanwhile, Takeshi, as I've told you that he is obsessed about exploration. I think this is like a time bomb, a reminder that the handover is coming. Time is ticking, the handover is approaching. So travel here connotes transition, that Hong Kong will be transited to another phase. So let's talk about Hong Kong as the background. The image of Hong Kong that we see in Chungking Express is, it is fully modernized, it is fully influenced by the pop culture or the Western culture. We see McDonald's, fast foods, we see convenience stores, and Hong Kong is more crowded and chaotic than Hong Kong in 1960 as portrayed in In the Mood for Love. So this chaos is not only the background but also the foreground as well. The two cops are obsessed with something. As I've said, that 223 is obsessed with the canned pineapples, while the 663 is obsessed with the objects in his room. According to Taher Abdel Mahid, that this chaos is portrayed through a manic noir tone to absurdist comedy. So Wong claimed that it is not just a love story theme that connects the two independent stories together, but also the idea that a lot of city people cannot find people to express their emotions to. So this is the core depiction of the citizens of Hong Kong prior to and after the handover process in 1997. The Hong Konger was so speechless and confused about their own future questioning whether they should stay or move out, or how Hong Kong will manage itself throughout the upcoming years. And what is very unique in this film is the popular speed motions. In the intro that starts with cop 223 chasing down a suspect in the middle of a dense crowd moving swiftly across the screen, he is being in focus while the background is in a state of a chaotic, blurry motion. So this sense of absurdity was achieved successfully in the film. Because on one hand, it portrays the loneliness in the crowd, that people surrounding them are blurred or not recognized, so they focus on it themselves. It just isolates the main characters from all the things around them. On the other hand, it also represented the notion of being lost within time and space after being extracted from reality. Oh, this comes to mind as well. Another music that talks about change is my favorite one. It's Things in Life, a reggae by Dennis Brown. This is metaphorically symbolizing everything in life that ought to be maintained and preserved from being lost. And also trying to look into the lyrics again, I found out that it's not every day we're gonna be the same way. So as time progresses, we also change. The Hong Kongers cannot predict what the future would turn into. And again, speaking of things in life, I also think of another main character in 223 storyline. It's the mysterious woman. As you can see that she rejects social connection by covering herself with sunglasses or a coat and wigs, which is exactly what the Hong Kongers felt at the time towards living with or being forced to live with Chinese. Similar to this woman, the citizens of Hong Kong enjoy higher standard of living and keeping a distance from mainland China because it gave them secure in due to the high competition that emerged at the time in the job sector after Chinese rule takeover. And finally, another element that plays a big role in this film is the Chungking Mansion. Space is suffocating. Like I said, this shows cosmopolitan nature and loneliness. That even though the closer they are, instead of living in separate houses, they live in the same house but just separate the room. But ironically, it doesn't make people close to each other. So all in all, Hong Kong here in Chungking Express are caught in a constantly evolving space where time can stand still or be momentarily captured, but will eventually bound to expiration. So again, in a way, Hong Kong exhibit yearning for a bygone era in Hong Kong history. Meanwhile, they are prompted to contemporary anxieties about the region's post-handover future. And the last of my sequel here, 2046, I can say it's when the real nightmare comes. So it is the prediction of Wong Kar Wai to Hong Kong after the official handover. Love is all a matter of timing. It's no good meeting the right person too soon or too late. If I lived in another time or place, my story might have had a very different ending. Zhou Mu Wan, 2046-2004. A according to the convention declaration that held on the handover ceremony in 1984, the year Hong Kong will be officially become a part of China is 2046. So studies suggest that this science fiction film is a sequel of In the Mood for Love. So the room number 2046, where Mr. Cho and Mrs. Chen frequently visited, is presumably as same as where Cho Mo Wan wanted to go in 2046. But 2046 is not only a time itself, but also a space, a state of mind, a memory, a life event, and the past, because it is set in 2047 after the handover. The characters chose the mechanism and reactions to Hong Kong and its loss that would happen after 2046. So by far, to Wong, this might be traumatizing to Hong Konger. So I found an interesting article by Lana Jane Stockton. She employs Freudian psychoanalysis to analyze the silent trauma and the mourning of melancholia to analyze and interpreting the trauma of an event that yet to be by repeating a trauma of interpretation that is constitute an event that never took place. So Sigmund Freud's theories on this unspeakable loss is that the memories before 2047 is the lost object. Freudian theory suggests that the proper process for dealing with loss is completed as an awareness of the separation of the individuals, maybe the protagonist, from the loss objects is accomplished. But they are unable to grieve their loss, so they are struggle. Because Hong Konger is losing their identity. Therefore, lonely male Lee turn lost desire to an ego to shelter them by subjecting himself to temporarily spatial and exile. So he also developed his displaced quality or loneliness quality. Characters has changed because according to Tony Leung, Wong Kar Wai told him to act like Cho Mo Wan, but being a little bit more like a playboy. So Cho Mo Wan here is more a little bit more aggressive because he wants to go back to Mr. Chen. According to In the Mood for Love, that they didn't end up together, he wanted to go back. So the futuristic train in 2046, on one hand, it was a time machine for those who fail to recall lost memories. But on the other hand, it can be interpreted as the transitional vehicle that, you know, transit Hong Kong to the frightening future. So this film overall is, it's intensively alarming the end of one country to system for Hong Kong. Well, just to recap here, Wong Kar Wai wants to talk about Hong Kong in his film, but he makes it in very poetic way. He transformed politics into a romantic drama movie that is very interesting. They are talking to Hong Kong because they all have these things in common. Wong talks about time, expiration date all the time. He is like someone who is always rushing to go forward, but also anxious to go forward as well. So they keep staring at the clock all the time to just wish that he would stop them. But he knows that he cannot stop time and cannot stop himself to go and facing the handover. The more he approaches the frightening future like this, he becomes more anxious. He also predicts that life after the handover, people in Hong Kong will become displaced because their identity is shaking again. They are living in such duality for a very long time. So they are always being traumatized all the time. And it is even more traumatized to stable them, because it takes their rights of speech, their right to do things that they want to again. Furthermore, all of these films also talks about loneliness in terms of how it goes hand in hand with modernity. Even though the urban life draws people to be physically closer, on the contrary, widen their distance apart. So this is coming to the end of my podcast now. Thank you again for listening to this very end. And as usual, if you have any questions to discuss or just to correct my mistakes, please feel free to do so by email me sudarachetana@gmail.com. Or for those who listened from YouTube, please comment below. And I hope I'll be seeing you. No, I'll be hearing you or talk to you in the next episode.